Welcome to VTU e-learning program. This is Dr. S. Nandagopalan. We'll be talking about the linked list continuation of my previous session. In the earlier session, we have discussed about the insertion at various points, like insert in the front, insert in the middle, insert at the end in a singly linked list. Now, in this session, let me just discuss about how to delete a node in a given singly linked list. Now, there are various scenarios which we can think of whenever we would like to delete a node from a given linked list. So let me just first share the PPT and let's now move on to discuss about the deletion process. Let me just so this is to share the PPT now. Right, so this is the slide which shows the deletion operation of the first node. So as I said earlier, there are three scenarios which we can think of deleting a node which happens to be the first node. On the other hand, let's assume that we would like to delete a node in the middle of a linked list, in which case we need to just the node to be deleted has to be searched, and then we can deploy the deletion process, which we'll see later. So now the idea is that we are given a singly linked list. Let's assume a simple example here, as I'm drawing a singly linked list with just three nodes. So this is my last node. This is my P, which is the pointer to the linked list. And let us assume that we have, 10, 20, and 30. So these are the info fields which we have. Now, the idea is that this node has to be deleted. So all that we need to do is just push this P here. So in other words, P has to be altered in such a way that it points to the next node. So that's exactly what we have shown here. P should take the address of next topic, that is this one, the address of the next node. So all that we need to do is simply execute this. Provided we have some nodes, at least one node in the singly linked list. So we need to first check, because simply doing this operation P equals next of P, in case if P is null or P doesn't have any nodes to point, then obviously it's going to end up with the runtime error, because P equals next of P. When P is null, you're not supposed to access any of its fields. So it's better that we first check this. In case if it's null, then we can say that node not, because obviously there is no node at all, it's empty list. So otherwise we can just execute this instruction P equals next of P and return the updated value of P. So that's how we design the function for deleting the first node. Now let's talk about how do we delete a middle node. Let's again assume three nodes here, 15, 12 and 47. Let's assume that we would like to delete node number 12 because it's a middle node. You can think of a very big list and any node in between, not the first, not the last. Because first node, of course, it could be, in this case, again, it could be the first node, which happens to be the key node. But we do not know where my key node really exists. So all that we need to do is we need to first check for the key node in the singly linked list, and then we can think of whether we could delete it or not once we find it, of course. So all that we need to do is that we first search for this starting from the first node. So I'll just use a pointer variable here, a temporary pointer variable called k, which starts searching from the first node, comparing this with the info field of p. So let's assume that the key to be deleted is 12. So all that we need to do is just compare this key value with kf info, that is the info field of k. If it is found, you can just stop that particular pointer called k. Otherwise, you can keep going. So we need a while loop in this case until we find the key node in the linked list. So we need to advance this pointer k every time we don't find that key node which is to be deleted. So this is a usual operation which we have already done for insertion as well, but in this case for deletion. So finding a node in the linked list, it's a standard procedure that we start from the first node, making k to point to that particular node, and then employ a while loop until we find that node. Okay, or we reach the end of the list. So there are only two possibilities. Either we get the key node or we, reach the end of the linked list. There's a last node. Because the key to be deleted may not be there in the list as well. So it's a not found case. So what we do is, since we have to delete the node, there is another important aspect of our deletion here. Now, assume that you have reached, the key node. Let's assume that we have reached the key node to be deleted. Now, simply having the pointer k pointing to the key node will not be able to delete this, because remember that if at all we want to delete this node, we have to actually take this pointer, that is next field, and then make this to point here. Now, how do you look back, or how do you get the address of the predecessor of this key node to be deleted? Now, sitting at this, it is not possible. So what we do is, we will just have one more pointer variable called predecessor, which actually follows this k. In other words, it is behind k. Now, assume that we have the predecessor, which is behind k, then once k reaches the key node, we have the address of the previous node, then we can access the next field of this, and then, we can make this to point to the next node. That means next of predecessor equal to next of k, because this is the address to be pointed. Automatically, now this node will be dropped or deleted. So that's exactly the procedure which we are going to follow here. So find the key node, and while we try to look for the key node, make sure that you also carry this predecessor pointer along with it. So we can see here that k points to p and predecessor one node behind. So behind this is nothing but nil. So that's exactly what we do here as part of the initialization. Next, we employ this while loop. As long as k not equal to nil, that means it's, not reached the end of the list, and info of k is not equal to x, where x is the key node. So x is the key node here, so that until either we reach the end of the list or we find the key node, you keep advancing. That means you keep browsing through this linked list. How? First thing is that predecessor is k and k is advanced. So always we ensure that predecessor will be behind k. So when you point, when you are pointing to k, k would have already advanced to the next node. So that is done by using this statement. And so this statement, the first one, will always make sure that it is behind k. Now, end of this loop, I mean, the loop could be broken only one of these two conditions is false. Okay, when does this happen? Either, you know, the node is not found, that means k is null, or the node is found in the linked list. Now, in our case, in this example, since it's not a not found case, actually the key is 12 and the key 12 is there, I mean, in the linked list. So obviously this information, I mean, this condition will be false, because when k reaches this node, k of info, in other words, info of k is actually equal to x. So this condition is false. So this comes out. So the moment we come out, we just check with the if statement, because of which condition being false, this loop has been broken. So we will have an if statement. Because of, I'll show you that in the algorithm in the next slide. So this is only to show you macro level kind of steps. So we need to check if, of course, it is equal to, that is k of info equal to x, then we can do this. Otherwise we can display that it is not found case. So the when the key is found in the linked list, all that we need to do is next of predecessor should be equal to next of k. So that's exactly what we have shown here. So the complete algorithm you can see here, because we need to take care of all the cases. Okay, so the first part, this one is same as what we have just now seen. And as I said earlier, we need to just check with if statement. So if at all, if this condition has become false, in other words, k equal to nil, then you can say that node not found, because we have checked each and every node and the key is not equal, and k would have come to the last node, in which case we would have got nil or null for k, in which case you can say not found. Otherwise, there are two possibilities. Either the predecessor is nil because only one node in the list, or it could be many nodes, in which case predecessor is not null. So when this condition is false, you can see here that we do this. Otherwise, so this automatically takes care of, even if the list contains just one element or one node, we can still do this, because by looking at predecessor, we have not advanced at all, because, you know, the first node itself is equal to the key. And after this, of course, the updated value of p has to be returned. So we can break this algorithm into, you know, two parts. One, look for the key in the linked list. So this portion will actually get you the key node in the linked list and its address, and the predecessor will point to the previous node. The second portion or second part is actually linking. That's it. So once you find this, yes, there is some node that is the else class, and you can either link or you can declare that the node is not found. Once you finish this, updated value of p, the third one, can be returned back to the caller or the calling program. So deletion in a singly linked list cannot be done with a single pointer, but we require an auxiliary or additional pointer like predecessor in this case. This is one of the disadvantages of the singly linked list. Okay, now this is another operation which you have already mentioned, that how do we search or browse through the linked list? So it's a very simple one. We have been doing this. So we just need to employ a while loop. While k not equal to null and k of info not equal to x, because we are trying to search for this, again, found and not found. It's a simple linear search kind of thing. So once, if we have the node being found, obviously k will not be null. And if k is null, node is not found. So return 0 indicates not formed. Return 1 indicates that it is formed. So the calling program can use this, or you can make the return type in a different way, the address of the key node. If it is null, the node is not formed. Otherwise, the node is formed. So that way also we can actually design this search node function. The return type in this case is given int, meaning 0 means not formed, 1 means formed. So this is a very simple algorithm in order to search for any key node being given. There are other operations which we can think of, stack, queue, other data structures. So don't get confused here. Why I'm connecting, or why I'm combining two data structures here, like linked list and stack. So don't get confused here. Let me just make it very clear that stack, queue, other data dictionary, other data structures can be implemented using a linked list, which is a dynamic structure. Same stack, queue, etc. can also be implemented using an array, in which case it becomes static. So stack as a data structure requires some containers, which can be either a static structure like an array or a dynamic structure like linked list. So that's all the difference. So I'm trying to use here linked list as a container, where my stack could be fully dynamic, because I don't really think of any overflow here. Because even if I have many nodes, as many as nodes, I can keep adding my linked list nodes. Supposing, assume that I start with 3 nodes in my stack, like in this case in the figure, I can actually add a node to the linked list, which means that I'm adding an object into the stack. It becomes 4 nodes or 4 objects in my stack. Assume that I have many such objects to be added into my stack. No problem. I keep adding my nodes into the linked list. So it becomes fully dynamic now, that there is nothing like overflow. Maybe an underflow is possible, because when the stack is empty, in other words, the linked list is empty, obviously, you can think of that underflow. That you're trying to retrieve some object from the stack. When the stack is empty, or when the linked list is empty, obviously you flag an error saying that it is underflow. So again, reminding you that how do we implement discuss here. So I've just written a linked list here that is having 3 nodes or 3 elements here, 15, 12 and 47. Now I can just tilt this 90 degrees, making sure that it looks like a stack. Okay, so this is my bottom of the stack, so which is 47. 15 is my top of the stack. So this P now becomes the stack pointer. So P becomes the stack pointer, in other words, the top of the stack. Now the elements within the stack are all linked in a singly linked fashion. So it's a stack, right? So supposing, assume that I want to push an element into the stack. So all that I need to do is just create a node, right? Link this new node with this existing stack and make this P to point to this. So this is my new node, an object being added into my stack. So now the stack has 4 elements or 4 objects. That's it. So basically what I need is insert in the front of a linked list, which I already done actually. So I can just call that function, which is nothing but a push, pushing an element or pushing a new element into the stack. So that's exactly what we have shown here, that I have 3 elements currently in the stack. I want to add a new element, say 99. So I create a new node, Q, in which I just put this info and make sure that I link this with this existing linked list. So all that I need to do is just do this. That is next of q equal to p, and p comes here. That's it. So two operations or two instructions. So next of q should point. So this is one, this is two. So next of q is equal to p, done. Then p should take the address of q, done. So if you tilt this 90 degrees, you can see here now p is pointing to 99 and then 15 and then 12 and 47 is the bottom of the stack. So the new element now is in the top. Supposing if I try to pop, this is the element which I would get. So that is nothing but accessing the first node in my linked list. So how does my push function look like? Simple, you know, put the info, get a new node Q, you have put the info, it's all done. So new element is put into the Q, and next of Q equal to P and P equal to Q. So these are the two steps which we already executed in the previous slide, and return the updated value of P. That's it. So push is correct. Now similarly pop. Pop, I'll show you with the diagram now here. So after adding my new node here, this becomes the top of the stack. So how do I pop this? Simply make this, you know, access this next of p, that is info, and then I can just advance my pointer to the next node. It's as simple as that, because basically I save this element for returning purpose, because pop is nothing but we have to return the top of the stack element. So first save this element, that is info of p should be saved in some local variable, and then advance this p to the next node, p equals next of p. So that would point to 15 in this case. So obviously this is deleted or popped. So before that, as usual, we have to check the underflow. See, you can see here that we have not checked any overflow condition here, unlike our conventional stack push operation, because it's a limited number of objects. That is, it's a static array. So obviously, we need to check for the overflow. But here, we don't need. In the case of pop, we need to check for the underflow, because you may be trying to retrieve some element when the stack is fully empty. So all that we need to do is first check this, whether it is nil. If so, stack underflow. Otherwise, save the element pointed by p and then advance p so that it points to the next node and you can return e. Right? But in this case, again, there are two possibilities. Either you can return e, the popped element. But one problem is that the updated linked list also has to be shown. So how do we manage this? In some languages like Python, you know, we can actually return both. Comma you can put, and then in the language point of view, actually. In some languages like C, for instance, you cannot return multiple values using the return statement. It should be only one. So you can use here a reference kind of a parameter that is passed by reference, and you can either, you know, show this or expose this updated value of p or the element which has been returned. We cannot do this both, you know, both the returned integer value as well as the pointer value, which is the updated value of the linked list, because once if I delete, supposing if I have four elements, I've deleted one, it should show three elements. So obviously I need to update my pointer, which I've already done it in this case, and make sure that that updated value goes back to the calling program. So that's exactly what we have shown here, return p. And in this case, the returned element is not shown. Maybe you can put a print statement here and then say that this is the element which is deleted or popped out. So either way, the design could go. I leave it to you. Now, the next data structure which we would like to implement using linked list is called as queue. So again, we have two functions. One is, you know, adding some element into the queue and removing an element from the queue. Again, we need two pointers for a queue, like in static data structures, that is front and rear, right? So we will maintain in the same way in the linked list as well. So this is the diagram which shows a typical queue, but this time it's not using arrays, but it's using linked list. So this is the first element being pointed by a front pointer, and the last element being pointed by the rear pointer. So remember that we need to actually add. That means whenever a new element is to be added into a queue, it is based on the rear pointer. Whenever an element has to be deleted from the queue, it should be from the front pointer, that is first in, first out. So how do we design this? Supposing, assume that we would like to add 15 into the queue. So the if we want to implement this from scratch, that means from empty queue, we know that both F and R should be nil. Both the pointers will point to nil, indicating that we don't have any elements at all. We don't have any element in the linked list. Right. So both now F and R, both front and rear, will point to that single node because this is the first element being added into the queue. So we just, as usual, create a new node called Q, info you put it, and then make F and R to point to this node. That means when both F and R are equal, there is only one element or node in the queue. Let's assume now we would like to add 12 into the existing queue. So this is the existing queue. Again, as usual, create a new node called Q and make the info, etc. So I'll just show you here if you want to understand it better, right? So we have here Q, new node, and what is the info? It is 12. So we have set up the new node. Now we need to link it. So based upon the rear point, that is next of rear should point to Q, and next of Q, of course, has to be null. That's it. So front pointer, we don't alter. Now we can see here that the front pointer is pointing to 15 and the next of 15 is pointing to 12. You can see here. And then the next of 12 is null. So once you set up the new node, its next field is null. And linking is very simple. Next of R should be equal to Q. So this linking is the main thing which we need to do it in order to make sure that a new node is added at the rear. So similarly, 47, the third element, same thing. And this time, you know, again, next of R should point to the queue. And you can see now that there are three elements in the queue. F being pointing to the first one because the first element which we have added was 15. So first in, first out, etc. Now removing an element from queue is very simple because all that we need to do is just advance. Of course, you have to check for underflow. Here, no overflow as usual, like stack. Now, if you want to remove an element from queue, all that you need to do is first check whether F is pointing to null or nil. And if so, it's an underflow. Else, we need to just advance this. F equal to next of F. So same scenario I've shown here, three nodes and F is pointing to first, R is pointing to the last node. So deletion, of course, very simple. Just advance F provided it's not null. So let's now look at the algorithms here for adding a new node or element into the queue, which we call it as NQ. So we have two pointers F and R, and E is my element to be added. So get the memory for Q, put the info, and put the next field as nil. And if F is nil, Then is the first node being done? So both F and R will point to Q. Otherwise, we have some nodes, in the sense many nodes, not just one. So as we already explained earlier, so we need to just have two instructions. One is next of R. You can see here, next of R should be equal to Q, and R should take on Q, pointing to the new node called Q. So that's NQ. DQ. DQ is again FR element being deleted. So it could be a reference pointer, returned element, you can see here. And if F is nil, it's an underflow, Q underflow, and return minus one. Else you can actually advance the friend pointer. Before that, of course, we have to save the node value pointed by F and then advance. And you can return return E, that's fine. So this is not required here. Maybe the return type is integer, etc. As I said earlier, again, the updated value of F and R should be shown. So this could be reference pointers. Reference variables or parameters, so that both F and same thing is true here also, because remember that whenever the pointer variables are getting changed in this function, it should get exposed to the calling program. Some people, that's not an industry standard, some people declare F and R as global and they don't pass it as parameters. Now, I discourage such kind of design mechanisms, because normally it is not a good practice or best practice to declare global variables. As much as possible, you need to pass it as parameters, and wherever required, make it as reference. Okay, so this is about the Q being implemented using the linked list. Well, this is just for the listeners. You can think of how we could make it, a linked list as an ordered one. Because remember that any linked list which we build is as and when we get elements, or as and when we get the data, we keep adding the nodes either in the middle or in the front or somewhere at the end. So it depends upon how you take it up. So the nodes being, or the elements being shown or added into the linked list, is in a haphazard manner. Assume that you would like to, keep your linked list, that means the information in the linked list, in a more ordered fashion. For example, it could be employee records or the student data, and it's based on USN, it's be ordered. So that's easy to search even if we try to go through the linked list, or even if you take a note of your data in the linked list, you can think of that when it is ordered, it's easy. But unfortunately, when a linked list is built, normally it is in a haphazard manner. So it's not based on any particular key like your USN or employee ID or phone number, something like that. So it is not based on ordered kind of thing. Now, in case if you want to build a linked list, while building itself, make sure that it is being ordered based on, let's say, names or employee ID or any other field. It is possible that we can build one such linked list, which is called as ordered linked list. Assume that I have, some names starting with B, some names starting with A, then some names starting with D. Okay. Probably you may also have next C. So assume that I have four names A name starting with B, a name starting with A, a name starting with D, a name starting with C. So in the normal scenario, assume that you are trying to build a linked list or construct a linked list. As and when we get, assume that it's being added in the front. So B goes first, A goes prior to that, D goes prior to that, and C goes prior to that. So insert front actually would construct a linked list as C, D, A, B. So that is not ordered. So what we mean here ordered linked list is that assume that the first node is B, right? So this is my first node. Okay. The next node or the next name is A. So what I should do, I should actually put this front of B. So now what happens? Now my new linked list would look something like this. A, then B, right? Right, so then I get D. So what happens, I should make sure that I insert this node in such a way that it maintains this order. So what I do is I'll just keep comparing my D from the beginning of the list. It's greater, no more node, so I can insert here. So just put this here. D. Next, what happens? I get a name starting with C. So again, same thing. I compare this with this. It's greater. Compare this. It's greater. Now it is less. C is less than D. So I should not add after this. I should actually add this node prior to this. So the new node should come here so that I can have A, then B, then C, then D. So every time when you want to add a new node into an existing linked list, and if you want to make this an ordered one, all that you need to do is just compare this from the beginning of the list until you find a position where it maintains this order and insert this new node. It could be front, first node, it could be last node, or it could be a middle one. So these are the three possible scenarios. So I leave it to you as an assignment or exercise in order to write one such, algorithm or program so that this becomes what is known as an ordered linked list. So when you browse through starting the first node, you always get the ascending order of names of the employee records. So I'll just end my session here, and maybe in the next session we will talk about the another type of list called as circular linked list. See, hitherto probably we have not thought of a circularity. It's a flat list where the last node, next field is actually null. So we have a dead end starting the first node. We have a dead end, but in circular list, there is no such dead end. Actually, the last node, next field will point to the first node. So what is the advantage of one such circular linked list? And how is it different from the normal singly linked list? We will discuss that in the next session. So thanks for watching, and go through this again, you'll be able to understand very easily. Thanks.